Thank you, Paul. And good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship this morning with the Presbyterian Church of Western Springs. We're glad to have you here with us today, whether you are here in person or joining us online. If you are online, I recommend that you download our bulletin at presbyws.org/worship. I want to remind everybody that our weekly connection has important things to know about activities in the life of the church, and there are copies of it in the narthex if you're not receiving it, and if you'd like to sign up, you can go to the website or call the church office or just let us know. And as we're getting closer to into Lent and into Holy Week, there'll be more announcements there. You'll just want to keep up to date on that. A couple of things I also wanted to share about. There's a book, a Lenten book. There are a few copies in the little elevator lobby there outside the narthex. And a lot of folks have been reading this book daily. There are very short readings, which I like for the daily readings. And then readings that connect to the scripture that I'm using on Sundays during Lent. They're not, I'm not going directly in the way that the writer talks about, but I think that's good because it gives you another perspective on the text as well. And out of this book, you'll see kind of this theme that's developing during Lent of the pot of soil that has now sprouted some green, which is exciting. So each week, I'm not going to point it out every week because I think that takes away some of the letting you meditate on the art. So each week, take a look, see what's developing as we are on our journey as well during this Lenten time. Another opportunity for you to gather with some others is a new book of the early risers are reading. We meet on Thursdays at 7 a.m. It's early, and this Thursday, I'll warn you, it'll be dark when you get up, right, because of the time change. Congratulations, by the way, everybody, on making it today. We'll see who comes at 10:30. It'll happen. This is a good book. It's 5 weeks of reading and a few chapters every week. There's a little reading schedule. It's called Accidental Saints, Finding God in All the Wrong People by Nadia Boltz-Weber. Nadia Boltz-Weber is a Lutheran pastor in Colorado area and a very unconventional pastor, which is part of why she has a lot of popularity, because she shows a little different side of what it means to be a pastor and how she sees the world in which she interacts. I'm really excited about this. Some folks have started reading it and are enjoying it. What I've said is that she's very masterful with words, so it's very easy to read and very enjoyable to read. Copies of this book are available in right outside my office downstairs. They're $10. As always, I have a copy right here, so if someone wants it during the passing of the peace, you just tell me and I'll give it to you. April 9th, ladies, mark your calendar. Men, you can mark your calendar too. Husbands, you can take the day off. On that day, the women are having a retreat, a one-day retreat. It's going to be at the center, which is quite close, and Teresa Dixon and Mindy are putting that together with some others. It's going to be a day of art and a day of some physical exercise or exercises and connecting body, mind, and spirit. And so that's coming up April 9th. The details are going to come out in an email very soon, but Mindy, give a wave, and Teresa's right there too, and what's that? And Loretta's there too. You have no excuses, ladies. You can talk to one of them. They're here, and I think it's going to be a wonderful time for you to gather in person together at the center April 9th. Thank you to Cammie and the No Name Band for being with us and leading us in worship today while Stephanie is away today, and we appreciate you all guiding us and leading us. Next Sunday, we will gather for worship, of course, and then after worship, we'll stay in this space for our annual meeting of the congregation. It's a brief meeting this time around because we do a lot of our business in December, and so we invite you to stick around. We'll have the annual report available so you can see what went on in the life of the church and see those important things. So I hope you'll be with us. Well, I think that's all of our announcements for the day. So let us worship God. Walt will lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning. Please stand if you're able and join me in the call to worship. We gather in this Lenten season knowing we are broken. Come and be seen. We gather in this Lenten season knowing we need forgiveness. Come and be heard. We gather in this Lenten season knowing our hearts long for God. Come and be loved. We gather in this Lenten season knowing God calls us all. Come as you are.
But I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
As we gather this morning for worship, we recognize that our lives are full of choices, choices about how we live and how we love. Let us take a moment and confess to God, acknowledging our need to be reconciled to God. We'll pray first in silence and then using the responsive prayer printed in the bulletin. Our heavenly Creator, you have called us to heavenly things, and you've called us to be born of the Spirit, to live into the birth of our baptism. Help us to choose the path that leads to new life. As you called Abram and Sarah out of her homeland, so too you call us to a new and unexpected places. The mysteries of the Holy Spirit call us to new and unexpected journeys. Help us to choose the path that leads to new life. Jesus spoke in paradox, proclaiming that those who wish to save their lives must give up their lives and follow him. Grant us strength to take up our crosses and follow. Help us to choose the path that leads to new life. Give us power to bathe once more in the waters of your baptismal font. Give us strength to remember that we are blessed so that we might bless others. Help us to choose the path that leads to new life. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. God invites us to experience God's newness, God's goodness, and God's love. We are forgiven, welcomed home, and loved by God. Amen.
Friends, having been reconciled to God, let us also seek to reconcile ourselves to one another, that in doing so in this place we might be prepared evermore to be ones who bring reconciliation and peace into the world around us. And so the peace of Christ be with you, and I encourage you to pass the peace of Christ to those around you. We got something kind of fun to talk about today. And I'm kind of going to be talking to you guys, but also talking to our grown-up friends, too. I'm making a little extra noise today.
So what I wanted to talk about is the world around us a little bit, and there's something going on a faraway part of the world that you guys know about, right? What's that? Ukraine's having a fight, and it's pretty bad, right? And you guys learned a little bit about just how bad it is, especially for who? Who were you thinking about? Ukraine, and the kids too, right? The kids there and the people there. And when I heard that you guys were concerned about it, it was really kind of helpful to me because you guys decided we can't just do nothing, right? And what did you guys say?
We need to donate.
We need to donate. And you went to your mom, both of you, and said, we feel pretty strongly about this, right? Sit with that for a moment. Sit with that for a moment, everybody, because when Rainey and Lawson heard about what was going on, their first thought was, we need to help. And as I'm thinking about this, guys, I think that one of the things I'm hearing, too, is you guys came up with some ways that not just you could help, but other people could help, right? And so tell me a little bit about that. And I'm going to repeat it to you guys out there. Don't worry. Go ahead. Tell me what you guys were thinking. Yeah. Okay. So, basically, this is the idea that Rainey and Lawson looked for some things that they have that they might be willing to give up, right, and not have anymore. And they're going to create a stand where they're also creating things and making things that they're going to sell and sell things of their own to help people that, do you know all these people you're going to help?
No.
No. Have you ever met them? No. And do you think you ever will meet most of them?
Yeah.
You might not, right? You might not meet them. But you're going to help them by selling these things and doing this. And I just want to say thank you to you guys because you're teaching us about what it means to see pain in the world, because that's what you saw, right? You saw people who are hurting and people who are without, and you said, we have to help. But I think sometimes us grown-ups can say, well, I'm not sure I can help. I'm not sure what I can do. It's so far away. But you guys are teaching us that there are things that we can do, right? There are things that we can all do. And so I want to say thank you for teaching us because you've taught us that lesson. And I want to share that this is happening today from 1 to 3 p.m. And you can talk to Stacia, give a wave, Stacia, or you can talk to Rainey and Lawson about where it's happening. And I also want to share that Presbyterian Disaster Assistance is also on the ground in Ukraine, and the funds that we are going to give to PDA through the One Great Hour of Sharing offering is also a way to help, but you can also give directly to these guys with Stacia because they're raising some funds that are going to go to another nonprofit that's also in the ground. There are a lot of people working very hard in Ukraine right now to show love, but I know you don't do this just so that people can be excited about it, but I think, can you guys show that you're excited about it? Give it a little... It's pretty cool, and I just want you to know that your church is excited with you and finds that this is important too, and we support you in it, all right? So thank you guys for doing this. So let's say a word of prayer, and then you guys are going to head off to your class, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for showing us that when we see others hurting, help. And God, we pray for the work that Rainey and Lawson are doing. And we thank you, God, for them. And the way that they're teaching us. And let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you, guys.
Our scripture lesson this morning is from Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 12 and 17 and 18. Listen for the word of the Lord. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward the heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. And then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord, who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know I shall possess it? He said to him, Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought them all these and cut them into two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. When the sun had gone down, it was dark. A smoking firepot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your descendants I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are in awe of your word and in awe of your presence in our lives and your presence throughout history and throughout humanity. God, help us to see something new in your word for us this day, that we might grow and be changed. Amen. This week's scripture lesson that Walt just read for us is from Genesis chapter 15, as he said. And it's a recounting of a vision that Abram, and this again is before his name has been changed to Abraham. We've talked about this before. This is the early time, his given name, Abram. And this vision comes to Abram when the word of the Lord came to him. That's how the vision comes. I've preached before a bit about Abraham and Sarah. Again, they're Abram and Sarai right now, but I think it helps to get a little bit of context to where this morning's text falls within the Abraham and Sarah text. When we first encounter Abram and Sarai, it's in chapter 12 of Genesis. The first 11 chapters of Genesis, again, the first book of the Bible, the first 11 chapters move very quickly from the two creation stories in the first two chapters of Genesis, and then the Adam and Eve in the garden, the fall from the garden, and then the dramatic and tragic stories of their sons, of course, Cain and Abel. And then we have Noah and the ark, the great flood, the Tower of Babel in chapter 11. These are very rich texts. They're rich texts that lay what will be the foundation for the Jewish faith, for the Jewish religion. They do two things. They in part seem to explain some of the confusing mystery of God, but then they add to the confusing mystery of God. So there's this dual function that can sometimes be a difficult dance, and you have to read those chapters from a perspective that comes to it of trying to understand more of who God is by reading the text. I distinguish that from reading a history book that's going to tell me exactly what happened A, B, C, D, E, F, G. This is an attempt rather to help us to understand more again of this mystery of who God is. And so in these opening chapters of the Bible, God is creating a lot. God's doing a lot of creating. And then creation, though that which is created, particularly the ones created in God's image, the people, the humans, us, creation seems to over and over again fail. Fail at understanding what it means to be made in the image of God. The first 11 chapters of Genesis are going to set forth a pattern that we're going to see throughout the Bible, throughout the modern era, as the church was growing and created, and then all the way into our contemporary life. It's a pattern of God's faithfulness, God's continued faithfulness, and the continued nature of humanity toward sinfulness, that is, towards an attempt to separate ourselves from God or to do actions that would separate us, would seek to separate us from God. And it's the continued presence of God working within creation to restore and bring about order. And more than that, to reconnect humanity with God. So God is consistently reaching out to humanity. Humanity turns from God, and God reaches out again, reconnects again. One text describes it this way. Through the lens of these images, the God of the opening chapters of Genesis is portrayed as a relational God. Most basically, God is present and active in the world, enters into a relationship of integrity with the world, and does so in such a way that both the world and God are affected by that interaction. God has not chosen to remain aloof from creation, but to get caught up with the creatures in moving toward the divine purposes for the world. And so this is the backdrop of those first 11 chapters, the foundation upon which the story of Abraham will be built. There's a fast-paced and rich genealogy that you can read in chapter 11 that leads us, ultimately arrives at this otherwise indistinguishable man named Abram. From the outset in chapter 12, when we're introduced to Abram, God makes clear God's plan for Abraham and Sarah. This is what is written. Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Those are the first words that Abram hears from God in Genesis chapter 12. There are two promises there that God makes. You're going to have land and a lot of it, and you're going to have offspring and a lot of them, right? A lot of progeny. You're going to fill the land with your descendants. At this time, when God comes to Abram and makes this dual promise, he and Sarai are living a life that's pretty good. It's a life of relative luxury in a place called Haran. They're surrounded by family. Historians have been able to determine that during this time, most people didn't really leave their hometown. In fact, they lived within about equivalent of about 10 miles or so from their families. And Abram was there with his family, and Sarai was there. Abram was a descendant of Noah. He was quite established where he was. The society in which they were living, though, was not a very godly one. In fact, it had grown far from the God that we know of as the God of the Old Testament. But they were in this land called Babylon, and polytheism was quite rampant. In fact, I was reading one ancient Near East historian who said that the texts from that time mention the names of at least 3,000 gods. So there were a lot of gods, and even accounting for the fact that some of the deities were given different names but were treated as the same ones, this same historian concluded that that more than 300 distinct gods were worshipped during that time. And so Abram and Sarai and their parents before them worshipped the many, many gods and idols of their day. The approach during this time, though, the treatment of gods during this time was basically one where people, especially with people with power and money, would spread their bets, their offerings, among the various gods. We'd say they wanted to have all their bases covered, right? They were just making sure. Keep all the gods happy because we don't know if they're real or not, but we don't want to bet against them. But the interesting thing about all these gods is that they weren't gods who made promises. They weren't gods who made promises. They're gods who made demands. Gods who required something for something else, a quid pro quo. These gods were responsible for punishment and maybe for good if you did something they wanted or something right. So you can imagine in this backdrop that Abram is a bit surprised when this God comes and the only thing that this God asks of him is to go. God says, go. But then God doesn't just say, go. God says, I'm going to do a lot more for you than I'm asking of you. Right? God makes promises. I'm going to give you these two things that are unfathomable to him. I'm going to give you land and children and lots of descendants. Abram is comfortable there, though. He's powerful, and at the age of 75, he doesn't need God or anyone else making promises like this, promises that are going to totally upend his life. And yet, that's exactly what God does. This inconvenience of God's call to Abram is made more significant by the fact that God doesn't tell him where to go, doesn't tell him where to go or what he's supposed to do. If it wasn't enough for God to call Abram away from his present life, from his comfort here, God tells Abram that he's supposed to take his wife and go. Go to the land that God will, at some point, show him. Go to the land that God will show him. And for some reason, we don't fully understand why, for some reason, Abram and Sarai do go. They listen to God's message for them, a message louder than their wealth and the position they have in society, and louder than the many gods and idols and the complacency of their known lives. They listen to God's message for them, and they go. They start their journey. But there's a major problem here that you probably already know with one of those promises in particular. Abram and Sarai do not have any children. These promises that God's made to Abram and Sarai seem particularly impossible, especially for them to be the ancestors of a great nation. It's impossible if you don't have children. I want to take a pause for a moment about and talk about Abraham a little bit. Abraham is probably one of the most revered people in church history and in what I would call almost the lore of the church. If we asked who were the important people, Abraham and Sarah are probably going to come up in that conversation. There were VBS songs, right, and camp songs that we all knew about Father Abraham. Had many sons, right? I was not going to sing that to you, but that's how it is. And what's the next part of that? And many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. Jim can sing. I can. But we learned these songs. We learned about Abraham, and our focus was always on Abraham, kind of as an ideal. And when we hear these texts, I think sometimes we think, oh, yeah, that's Abraham, the perfect one. Let him be the one that exemplifies or models what it means to be a follower of God. And all of this is for good reason, because the spoiler alert, of course, is that Abraham and Sarah, they do have the many offspring, the descendants that God promised. And Abraham will eventually obtain a great deal of land, and the offspring will inhabit the land, and Abraham and Sarah's legacy will lead to the creation and establishment of the Jewish faith. This will all happen. God will do it all through these two. We wouldn't be reading this text if that didn't happen. But not yet. Abraham and Sarah do leave as God tells them to do. They take a group of folks, Abraham takes this group, and they go to the land called Canaan. And when they get there, the Lord appears again and says, this is the spot, this is the place, this is the place that your people are going to inhabit, your offspring will inhabit. And so Abraham builds an altar there on that spot, and then something kind of perplexing happens. They get up and leave. They keep going. This is a point that isn't looked at a lot in the text because it happens so quickly. They leave. They continue on. But when they continue on, they run into trouble. They experience great famine, and everyone is in dire straits. And so they decide to go down to Egypt in the hopes that it would be better there. But now they're in a foreign place. They're in a foreign land. And in a state of desperation, Abraham decides that he needs to fix this, or he's going to die, right? He's not going to have food. So he decides to take his wife and pretend that his wife is his sister and give Sarah to the Pharaoh to take as Pharaoh's wife. There are a lot of bad things that we can do. I think this ranks at about the top. And I think sometimes Abraham is criticized too much for it. Well, I don't think that. People think that. They want to ignore it. I can't ignore it. And they want to look at it and say, well, Abraham needed to stay alive in order to do what God told him to do. Okay. Abraham needed to keep everyone else alive. Okay. But no, it's not enough. For me, it's not enough. Because he hands her over, and in exchange, he's given a load of sheep, oxen, donkeys, camels, and even servants. And again, there's some practical decision-making going on that Abraham has to do here, and he's right. He does survive because of this decision. But his wife also becomes a wife to the Pharaoh and all that comes with that. But God does have these promises that God has made, right? God has made these promises. And even though Abraham seems to have panicked and made what I would call a morally compromised or perhaps even reprehensible decision to use his wife to save his own life, God doesn't let Abraham's failure end the story of God's promises. Remember what's going on here in Genesis. God creates, people mess up, God recreates. And so God sends some plagues to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh is very confused. What has someone done here that's wrong? And the only thing he can tie it to is his new wife. And so he goes to Abraham, and Abraham tells the truth, and Pharaoh basically says, why would you have done that? And releases Sarah, the plagues go away, Abraham and Sarah are reunited, God recreated. So, it's time for more human messing up, isn't it? Abram and his nephew Lot, so Lot has gone with them, Abram and his nephew Lot, they're not getting along. They're not getting along, and Abraham is getting frustrated with him. This traveling band has gotten a bit too large, and Abram decides it's time to break up the large caravan, and he sends Lot on his way. They go their separate ways. But Lot's army is small now, and so what happens? An enemy comes and overtakes them. And Abram hears of this. And it's hard to tell how enthusiastic he is about it, but he goes and they overcome the threat. They're reunited. They're reunited. His inability as a leader, though, obviously is part of what led to this separation. But God recreated again. God brought them back together. And in all of this, these ups and downs, and there's more within these chapters. If you want to have fun, go read them. There's more that happens, and there's going to be more. So we're in chapter 15 here. There's going to be more after it. But in all of this that's happened, all of those things that I just listed, there's still no offspring at this point. There are these lingering promises of God, and Abram is confused. And if the confusion wasn't enough, he's probably got an angry wife too, frankly, a bitter wife. He's got a bitter nephew in Lot. After these things, this is when we come to this morning's text. In fact, that's how the text started. I don't know if you heard it when Walt said it at the beginning. After these things. So now you know the things. The things that happened. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. After these things, God comes and God makes the two promises again. Remember, he already made these promises before. I'll give you land and I'll give you offspring. Descendants that are as numerous, he says now, as numerous as the stars. In our Bible study this week, it was pointed out that in another part, the promise is as numerous as the dust. In another part, as numerous as the grains of sand. And Abram has heard all this before, right? He's heard it before. He's heard it before these things, and now here after these things, he's hearing it again. And the promise comes again, and Abram is confused. He's confused, and I read a little bit of defeat into it too. It's like, I did all this. I left. I did what you wanted. After these things, here we are again. Here we are again. It's hard to understand. It's hard to understand how these promises could be fulfilled. As I look around the world today, it is hard after these things to hear the promises of God. As I look at images coming out of Ukraine, stories of children traveling hundreds of miles by train on their own to escape death, knowing they won't see people ever again, people they love. As I hear stories from people who have escaped other atrocities, some decades and a lifetime ago, people for whom these crimes of today are bringing back terrifying memories that they had buried long ago with the people they loved, after these things. 2 years of lost events, lost experience, lost lives, and lost innocence. In the world with this pandemic. 2 years of tension and conflict that has spilled into families and friendships and churches. After these things, the things of your lives that I know some of the stories, but I don't know half of them, the things of loss, of grief, of pain, after these things. And things that are coming down the road, the things that give us fear, that haven't even happened yet. These things After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. The Lord said, "Fear not, Abram. I am a shield to you. Your reward will be very great." After these things, the word of the Lord came. After these things, in the midst of these things, through these things, God's promises will spring forth. God's promises will come out of dry ground. After these things is precisely when comes the newness of God's recreation, God's ongoing recreation, God's surprising recreation. After these things is when life springs. After these things, when we will be led by young children who show us how to love the world. When we can't even see a path to do that sometimes. But not only when children will show us how to love the world by creating and selling and inviting others to be a part of loving others, but showing us and teaching us that we too need to be ones who do that. After these things, God's recreation, where God surprises God's people because God keeps God's promises. After these things. A lot will happen after these things for Abraham and Sarah. But the hard part, or the hard reality of this story, is that there's going to be a lot more pain. It gets worse. If you thought it couldn't get worse from what you heard, after these things, it gets worse. There will be more pain, more things to come. The image of the animals being split in two, did you catch that in the text today? It's kind of graphic, right? But this idea is part of a covenant. It's like a super promise. And the way it worked is you'd cut the animals, put them in half, and then the person making the agreement would walk between the cut pieces of animal. And in our text today, at the end, there's this mysterious fire pot. Go back and read it. I'm not going through the whole text, but at the end, there's this fire pot that goes, and the smoke goes through between the animals, and that is God's presence making the promise. The one making the promise goes through the animals. You've heard the phrase, cut a deal, right? We're going to cut a deal. That's where this comes from. You cut the animals, you go through, you make the deal. This is a super promise. Super promise. But Abraham and Sarah need it again. They get it later. In fact, they get it more than once later. God needs to tell them again. And they make more mistakes, they have more problems, more disorder, more failures, and God continues over and over again to recreate. But right here in this text, there's something powerful that I couldn't ignore. Abraham is struggling to understand how God will do all these things that God promises. He struggles to understand it. And I hope you can take some comfort in that. I hope you take comfort in knowing that Abraham, Father Abraham, the one we revere and look up to, I hope you take comfort that he struggled in understanding how God's goodness would come. I do. I do for sure take comfort in that. Because I struggle with it. I wonder if you ever struggle with this, with understanding how God's goodness will come. But Abraham, our text says, very quickly it changes, and our text says Abraham believed the Lord. But digging a little deeper, this word belief, it meant something different, a little bit different. It might help to have a little color on this, to say a better way to understand it might be that he trusted God profoundly. The idea of belief really meant a profound degree of trust, trusting profoundly. Even when Abraham can't see the path forward, he trusts God profoundly. He trusts God, and he continues to allow God to recreate. Even in the midst of his failures, he trusts profoundly, even when he can't fully understand what that even means. What it means. When he can't dream or even comprehend. I find myself there sometimes, unable to even comprehend what it means to trust profoundly. When he can't dream after these things, somehow even then, he trusts profoundly because he trusts a God who is worthy of that trust. And trusting God, he dares to press forward. He dares to try. He dares to love, to dream about how he can live as though God is indeed worthy of that trust. Friends, may we too learn to trust profoundly, to learn who this God is that we are called to trust profoundly. And may we learn to dream about God's recreation in a broken world. May we be led by the youngest among us, the ones who teach us to trust profoundly. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Seated. Friends, as we go to God in prayer, I remind you that in our weekly connection, the prayer concerns are listed of the church. It's updated every week as folks request to be added. And I invite you to use that list as a guide for you in prayer. You can take and use it as an opportunity to pray for others and for them to know that they are held in prayer. And so I invite you to be doing that. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we pray this day for all who are on our prayer list, especially for those who are awaiting treatment or diagnosis, those who are struggling. We pray for those who are experiencing loss. God, I pray for those who are struggling through periods of grief, whether extended grief or raw and new. Pray that you would be with them. God, I pray for a world that is filled with war and rumors of war. Especially, we pray for the people in Ukraine and those who are seeking refuge. We pray for those who are caring for them and helping them. God, we pray for other parts of the world that are particularly trepidatious right now, for leaders who are seeing opportunity to perhaps exert their own forces in ways that would bring further suffering in this world. God, we pray that their hearts would be softened, they would be guided in a way that leads to peace. Gracious God, it is one thing to pray for peace, but we also pray that we would be given eyes and minds and hands to see how we can be a part of helping usher in peace in this world, helping bring peace into the lives of those around us, those in our church community, those in our local community, those in our world. Stir within us. Help us have the eyes of the young. Gracious God, we pray as cold weather continues, we pray for those who lack sufficient shelter and lack food. We pray for those who are experiencing scarcity both physically and emotionally and mentally. We pray for all who are experiencing mental health issues, anxieties that are continuing to mount in this world today. Be with them. God, we give you thanks for a community of love, a community that knows how to love like you love, and who seeks to love like you love. May we be a place of welcome and invitation to others, that all might experience your love in this place. Amen. Friends, during our time of worship, we continue to receive our offerings and dedicate them to God and to God's work in the world. There are baskets in the back. There are ways you can also give online, but we dedicate those gifts. I remind you again of our work that we are doing with the Second Baptist Church of LaGrange Food Pantry. Thank you to those who've been bringing food items, especially this past week. I appreciate that very much. I had sent out a note in our weekly saying we could use some extra help, and folks did, and so let's keep that momentum going. I also wanted to have another tease for you about our upcoming Lenten and Beyond mission project that we're going to hear more formally about next week, but the mission committee did meet again and is ready to move forward with this project that will be helping with refugees who will be coming to the Chicagoland area they're already coming, but the family we'll be supporting will be coming in the coming months, and so there are going to be ways for everyone to be involved, anyone who is able to be involved either by helping with a weekly commitment or even ways that you can help by not devoting too much time. If you need to write a check, you can always help in that way. So this is your teaser about more information to come next Sunday. If you want to know more, ask me or talk to Kathy Winterstrom as well. But like I say, it's exciting. This is a big way for us to be able to help folks who will be coming to Chicagoland in the very near future, escaping places where they would otherwise be suffering. Friends, we are going to sing our final hymn. I'll invite you to stay seated, and then you'll be invited by, I think Amy will invite you to stand, and so just watch for Amy to give you the international sign of stand with her hand. Friends, let us continue to worship God.
Going and rejoicing, he is for you.
already by our band in that song. But let us go out into the world. Let us go out into the world to be that blessing to others, to trust our God who has made promises to us, even when those promises are hard to understand. Let us go out and be a blessing, and let us go, friends, with the love of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.